third foundation. Allah's Messenger came to a people who differed in their object of worship. Some worshipped angels, while others worshipped prophets and pious people. But the prophet did not differentiate between them.
The grave worshippers nowadays, when you recite the verses of Tawheed, they say, how could you treat us like idol worshippers? They say, we are supplicating to pious people, to walis, and you are comparing us to idol worshippers? You are unjust. That's what would they say. Now, the author here is showing that it is not true that the mushriks in that time were only worshipping stones. No. Actually, they were not worshipping stones. They were making some stones as symbols for either angels or pious people. But the Christians were not worshipping idols. They were worshipping Jesus. They were worshipping humans. And the Jews were not worshipping idols. They were denying it. And they were worshipping humans. They were worshipping their scholars or some other people. So we had also people who were worshipping the sun at that time. People who were worshipping angels. Therefore, it is not true that those verses were only directed to stone worshippers. You see, this is one thing. The other thing is that the grave worshippers nowadays are not only worshipping stones, they are worshipping what is much worse than stones. They are worshipping wicked people like Ahmed al-Badawi. Who is Ahmed al-Badawi? Al-Badawi was known to be an ignorant man who used to drink intoxicating drinks. And in the time that he was drunk, he used to go up the roof of the masjid and urinate on the people who were praying. He was not praying in congregation. He was getting drunk most of his time. And yet they were worshipping him after his death. It is better to worship a stone than to worship people like Ahmed al-Badawi. You see? All is shirk. All is greater shirk, but this is better than this, you know. So they have many graves which are not known what's in them. Some of them have dogs in them. Some of them have donkeys in them. Some of them have nothing in them, you see. They worship al-Rifa'i. Who's al-Rifa'i? Al-Rifa'i was the one who used to say, all the walis of Allah are under my foot. All the walis of Allah from the time of Adam are under my foot. A stone is much better than this ta'ud, you see. So, actually, we are not only being just with them, we are being lenient with them because they are worshipping what is much worse than stones, you see. So the verses apply to them. That's why the author brought this proof that any worship for other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala falls under this. Any worship for other than Allah. Actually, they don't know what is the meaning of ibadah. They don't know what is the meaning of shirk. They don't know. They are ignorant. That's why what they are doing. Because they don't know. If you tell them what is ibadah, they cannot define ibadah to you. You tell them dua is ibadah or not, they say no, not dua, not ibadah. How? Allah says it's ibadah in his book. How could you say it's not ibadah? They say no, it will only be ibadah if you call upon someone believing that he has the powers of Allah. Only that is ibadah. You see? But if you supplicate to him or call him, not believing that, then you are not worshipping him. We tell them, when someone supplicates to the dead, he wants his needs to be satisfied. How could this not be ibadah? Who is to be asked other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? He is asking a creature what he cannot do, what no one can do but Allah. So if this is not ibadah, then there is no ibadah. No. Yes, this is a very fine and accurate question. The scholars might not declare the mushrik a kafir. Why? Because if they declare him a kafir, then that means his wife must be separated from him. And there are rulings which should be applied against him. Maybe the ruling of killing him. You see, as the Prophet ﷺ says, "Man baddala deenahu faqtuluh." You see? So these rulings should not be applied by anyone first, only the one who is responsible, and should not be applied by anyone, only the scholar who has the right to give this ruling. If I see someone who is supplicating to the engraved, I can laughingly, if I'm allowed to laugh, say that he's a mushrik. I have no problem, because he's committing great shirk. So what can I call him? You see? But in order for me to call him a kafir, this is another subject. You see? This is another subject. In the normal situation, if one is not excused for his ignorance, you can call him a kafir. You see? You can call him a kafir. But if someone is excused, let's say someone who is living in a very far place from Muslims, a place in which no knowledge of Islam and Tawheed reaches, and he commits acts of shirk, and he doesn't know, and no one knows in his area. And he is in a remote area, he doesn't receive any information. He is a mushrik. I call him a mushrik. But in this case, I don't call him a kafir. You see? You notice the Shaykh al-Islam Muhammad bin Abdul Wahhab, in the beginning of his da'wah, when the shirk was widespread, he said, "We do not declare a kafir, not a mushrik, la nukaffir. We do not declare a kafir he who worships the grave of Abdul Qadir." Of course, he calls his action worshipping the grave. it's essential to know that worshipping other than Allah is shirk, right? But he says, لا نكفر. So he is making a distinction between calling him a kafir and considering him a mushrik, you see. This distinction is not known by many, unfortunately, students of knowledge of Salafis nowadays. They confuse the two issues. They think لا نكفر means we cannot call him a mushrik also. So what can we call someone who is doing shirk, great shirk? What can we call him? you only call him by what it appears. You don't know what's in his heart. If he is committing an act of, like what Sheikh Muhammad ibn Ibrahim said when he was told, "Why are you declaring people kafirs?" He said, "They showed us kufr. We declared them kafirs." Why are you asking us why we declared them kafirs? Why are you asking them why did you show kufr? If you wanted us to declare them kafirs, let them not show kufr, right? If someone curses Allah, I tell him you are a kafir. What else can I tell him? In the issues which are clear, issues of tawheed, supplicating to Allah or supplicating to other than Allah, these are clear issues. These are more clear than what is termed in Arabic as ma'loom min ad-deen bil-darura. Ma'loom min ad-deen bil-darura means some kind of knowledge which everyone should know, every Muslim should know. You know that the bread is halal, right? Water is halal, right? You know that khamr is haram. Right? This is ma'loom min ad-deen bil-darura. This is something which everyone who is Muslim must know. You know that worshipping Allah is an obligation. You know that shirk is haram. You see? So these issues, which are known for all Muslims, no one is excused if he lives amongst Muslims. Someone who is living amongst Muslims and he only find it obligatory to pray one time a day or four times a day. And when you ask him, why don't you pray Isha? He said, no, it's not an obligation. He's kafir because he is denying something which every Muslim should know. The only situation in which you don't declare him a kafir is like I mentioned earlier, when he lives in a very remote place where they don't know those things, or in a kafir's country, and he just became Muslim, and he doesn't know that wine is haram, or prayers are five, then you wait until you tell him, you see. And if he insists, he's a kafir, you see. So, in clear matters, you can declare him. If you see him do an act of shirk, you can tell him you are a mushrik. And if you die on this, you are a mushrik. Okay? But there are other issues which are called masail khafiyya, hidden issues. Not everyone knows. Maybe you don't know that a long beard is from Islam. So ignorantly, you come and deny it and you say, what is this dirt? Why are you doing this? Why don't you make your beard nice and this and that? What you're saying now is kufr, because you are calling the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ dirt. But this is a hidden issue. This is not as clear as the first, you see, because things have been confused even by the so-called scholars, you know. Some scholars say it's okay to shave the beard, not only to trim it or whatever, you know. So in this case, you don't declare him a kafir because he said something bad about the sunnah before fully explaining to him and convincing him, you see. Even sometimes matters of belief when it comes to sifat, attributes of Allah, things like that. We don't declare the Ash'aris to be kafirs. We declare them to be innovators, but we don't declare them to be kafirs. We don't declare the Hanafis, Maturidis to be kafirs. We declare them to be innocents, innovators, but not kafirs, okay? So this is how it should be. We should distinguish between the clear matters, المسائل الظاهرة, and the hidden matters, the hidden issues, المسائل الخفية. Also, when it comes to the Muslim ruler, the situation is even more complicated. Why? Because in the case of the ruler, if you declare him a kafir, that will not only affect him. If you declare me or Sajid, that's it, me and him. But if you declare the ruler, that will affect maybe the whole country, the whole people, the whole society. Therefore, there are two issues here. First, does he deserve the title kafir? Okay. This is decided by a trustful scholar who is eligible to give the fatwa. Okay. Second, after deciding that he deserves it, they should also decide whether it is time now to say it or not. Maybe if we say it, we will worsen the situation and we will create more evil. You see? So that's another thing. That also needs a fatwa from the scholars. You see? So this is if he is a ruler, okay? Or something like that. There are many, many narrations which are in Sahih Muslim and Sahih Bukhari and hadiths which show the danger of rushing into calling someone a mushrik or a kafir. You see? And this is something that all Muslims must be aware of, because it's not easy to call someone a kafir or a mushrik. But in the same time, you have to make kufr in ta'ut. Which means what? Which means that you tell the kafir that he's a kafir, okay? You don't have to tell him in the face, but at least you have to believe in it, and you have to be able to pronounce it and say it, that Christians are kafirs, Jews are kafirs, grave worshippers are kafirs, okay? So this is an essential part of faith. Allah says, فَمَنْ يَكْفُرْ بِالطَّاغُوتِ وَيُؤْمِنْ بِاللَّهِ. First, kufr in taghut. Then, faith in Allah, you see? So you will not be having kufr in taghut if you don't declare those kafirs to be kafirs, you see? You have to declare them kafirs. But those hadiths are for Muslims, you see? You cannot declare a Muslim kafir because he is sinning or because he disagrees with you. Yani, the Khawarij declared the companions to be kafirs. The Khawarij were worshippers. They were praying all night, all year. They were fasting all day, all year. Okay? And they were very much enthusiastic for fighting and going to Jannah and fight and so on. But despite that, it was very easy for them to declare someone who differs with them kafir. Okay? That's why the Prophet ﷺ said, "Hum kilabu ahli an-nar." They are the dogs of hellfire. And that's why he said, "Hum sharru al-khaliqati tahta adim as-sama." That they are the worst of the creation under the sky. Okay. And he described them with so much ugly descriptions. And he ordered to kill them. And he said, by killing them, you will be earning so much and much reward. You know, so much reward. You see? So this is to show the danger of calling Muslims kafirs. You see? Al-Hajjaj was a tyrant ruler. In his time, 100,000 or more were killed. Amongst them were Sahaba. But no one declared him a kafir because of this. They declared him a kafir. Some people declared him a kafir for other reasons. Because he used a verse in Quran in a mockery way once. Okay? When he put some prisoners in a fire place where is fire, and then they were shouting because of the fire burning their bodies, they were shouting. So he said, "Ikhsa'u fiha wa la tukallimun." He was using the verse that Allah will say to the kafirs in hellfire, "Ikhsa'u fiha," remain in it and don't talk to me. So he was using this verse, and this is mockery of Quran. So some declared him a kafir because of this, you see, not because of killing, you see. So therefore, it's to if you cannot call a man like Al-Hajjaj, call him a kafir, you see. So how about others? Yani, nowadays it's very easy to call someone a kafir, you see. If someone ruling a country, for example, and his country in the United Nations, then he's a kafir. Why? Because he's dealing with the United Nations. He's a kafir. They want the Muslims to be secluded from everything. No, this is not wala and bara. You have to. You are a Muslim now. And you are in a time where you have to be part of the United Nations. Otherwise, nations will attack you and you have no protection, you see. Because you are under no pact. Nothing, you see. And it is easy to declare anyone a kafir now just because they think you have wala for the kafirs. You are a kafir. And when you ask them, what kind of wala do I have? They'll tell you something which has nothing to do with wala. Nothing to do with wala, you see. Accepting a gift from someone who's kafir is considered a wala to them. This is not wala. having relations with a kafir country is wala to them. This is not wala. The Prophet ﷺ had relations with Jews, with Christians, with everyone. So what? So, unfortunately, it's not only takfir that is misused nowadays. It's also tabdi'a, to declare someone an innovator. This is not also easy. Although some people think it's like drinking juice, you know. They think it's jihad to call someone an innovator. So it's very easy for them to declare you an innovator, you see.
What is the ruling concerning Muslim movie actors who prostrate before the idols or say words invoking idols or say statements about Allah that are not appropriate as part of their job? They don't believe in what they say or do.
Belief is not a condition in clear kufr. And there is no difference between mockery and seriousness and kufr. All the same. When Shaykh al-Islam Muhammad bin Abdul Wahhab rahimahullah mentioned the nullifiers of faith, at the end he said, وَلَا فَرْقَ فِي ذَلِكَ. There is no difference between someone who is mocking or serious or saying it out of fear. Even out of fear, you become a kafir if you prostrate for other than Allah. Out of fear doesn't mean the situation of force. That's different. Force is the only exception. Illa man ukrih. Allah says in Quran about kufr, illa man ukrih. Only real force. You see? But just any fear, no. You cannot commit shirk. So how about those who are making it for money and mockery? This is great kufr. You see? No difference. But you have to hear it from him. Not anyone who is acting, we declare him kafir. You know, this is not, you know. But you have, as Shaykh al-Islam Muhammad bin Abdul Wahhab says, لا نكفر الشخص بما يبلغنا عنه حتى نعرف بأنفسنا ونتيقن. We don't declare a person to be kafir for what we receive of news about him, that he did this or that or said this or that, until we ourselves make sure and know the, يعني, what he said, you see. You don't declare, it's not easy to declare someone a kafir. Don't go by Al Jazeera news or whatever news, you know, or someone, even someone whom you trust. Be very careful, you see. Maybe he misunderstood. He is trustworthy, but he misunderstood, you see. So you hear it from the person himself. Then, only then, if it is clearly kufr, you can declare him a kafir. Otherwise, no. You see. Shaykh al-Islam Muhammad bin Abdul Wahhab, rahimahullah, in his time, shirk was widespread. And he said, we only declare someone kafir if he is doing something which is clearly kufr and shirk. And most of the nation is not like this, and grace be to Allah. وَأَكْثَرُ الْأُمَّةِ لَيْسُ كَذَلِكَ وَالْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ. Why? Because even though you think that a lot of people are doing acts of shirk, you don't base on what you think. You base on what you're sure. You see? Now, if someone coming from a place where graves are worshipped, I don't declare him a grave worshipper just because he is coming from there. Until I see him do the same action or say something which shows that it's okay to do it. Then I will tell him you are a mushrik. You know, if I want to give him da'wah, I might not tell him he's a mushrik. But I believe he's a mushrik. Okay. You talk to him nicely and show to him, prove to him that what he's doing is great shirk, right? You don't tell him, come on, you are mushrik, you are kafir, let me start with you and I want to show you the truth. He will tell you, no, just go away, I don't want. But you don't cheat him and tell him you are a Muslim, you see. You don't have the right to do that. You see? No. First, you have to be sure that they were on any type of great shirk. You cannot go by gesture or what you think. No, you have to be sure. Sheikh bin Baz, rahimahullah, was asked a question similar to this by some brother from Egypt or some person from Egypt. He said, I had a father who was he was praying and doing good things, and he went to Hajj more than one time and this and that. But he said, one time I heard him supplicate to the Wali, to the dead Wali, can I seek forgiveness for him, make dua for him after his death? The Sheikh said, if you know that he repented for what he has done that time, you can seek forgiveness. Otherwise, you cannot. Then he brought the hadith where the Prophet ﷺ said, استأذنت ربي في أن أستغفر لأمي فلم يأذن لي. And this is the mother of the Prophet ﷺ, and Allah did not give permission to the Prophet to seek forgiveness for her. You see? So if this is for the Prophet ﷺ, so how about us? You know? If you know that he died on shirk, you heard him, you saw him do shirk, and you never saw him or know that he repented from it, don't make dua for him. No, that's not enough to call him mushrik. No. Because not all Naqshbandis, or not all Rifa'is, or not all Sufis do this, yani. So we cannot go by gesture. We cannot go by thinking, just thinking that he might be or this or that. Now, if you know something sure, that's it. You can base on it. You should base on it.
Fourth foundation. The mushrikeen of our time are worse in their shirk than the previous generations.
The author here is pointing out to only one issue that makes the mushriks nowadays, the grave worshippers, greater in shirk than the previous mushriks who were the idol worshippers at the time of the Prophet ﷺ. And that is the issue of worshipping their gods in ease and in tough times. This is the current mushriks. While the idol worshippers were only turning to their idols in the ease times, when they were relaxed. But in tough times, they would sincerely call upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah will save them because of their dua, and especially they made it sincere. Nowadays, there is no time in which the grave worshippers turn to Allah alone sincerely. In the most difficult times, they turn to other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They call upon the names of so-called awliya instead of calling upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Another thing is that the grave worshippers nowadays commit shirk in lordship. And that is because they turn to their gods only instead of turning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So they became not only their gods who deserve worship, but they became their lords. They believe in the wali that he has the authority to run the affairs of the creatures. And if you don't believe in this, they consider you insulting the wali and not loving the wali. So to them, you will only be believing in the honor of the wali, karamatul awliya, if you believe in him in such a way that you consider him another god with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Otherwise, they will consider you slandering the wali. And that is to them kufr. Yani, you are to them kafir because you turn to Allah alone. You should turn to the wali instead of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in order for you to become a Muslim. Yani, things are upside down directly. You see? I heard one of them say in his dars that it is a great loss that someone who knows the wali and does not supplicate to the wali. It's a great loss, he says. While Allah says, supplicating to other than him is the greatest loss. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَنْ أَضَلُّ مِمَّنْ يَدْعُو مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ. Who is more astray than the one who supplicates to other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قُلْ يَا عِبَادِيَ الَّذِينَ أَسْرَفُوا عَلَىٰ قُلْ وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي فَإِنِّي قَرِيبُ أُجِيبُ دَعْوَةَ الدَّاعِي إِذَا دَعَانِ. If my worshipper ask you about me, I am near. I answer the call of everyone who calls me. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, مَنْ لَمْ يَسَلِ اللَّهِ يَغْضَبْ عَلِهِ. He who does not supplicate to Allah, who does not ask Allah, Allah will become angry with him. And those people say that if you want something, you supplicate to the wali, because they claim that the wali has been given the power by Allah to do whatever he wants. You see? And because they say you are not fit to supplicate to Allah directly. You say, they say you are a sinner, so you need a clean man, a tahir, you see. So turn to the wali. And this is one of the tricks of shaitan, one of the old tricks of shaitan, that he made the Arabs, the worshippers of idols, when they were making tawaf, he came to them and he told them, how could you dare to worship Allah by tawaf with your clothes on? Those clothes which you have sinned with, you should take them off and go around the grave, go around Kaaba naked, both men and women. And they believed him. And they would go around the grave naked, Kaaba naked, and say, labbaik Allahumma labbaik. And the woman, due to some shyness that she had, she would cover her private part with her hand. That's how shaitan could make them go that deep into darkness. And those are the same. Shaitan is telling them, you cannot worship Allah by supplicating to him directly because you are sinners and dirty. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Quran, قُلْ يَا عِبَادِيَ الَّذِينَ أَسْرَفُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ لَا تَقْنَطُوا مِنْ رَحْمَةِ اللَّهِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَغْفِرُ الذُّنُوبَ جَمِيعًا. Say, O my worshippers who have done, destroyed themselves with sins, who have done so much sins, okay, do not despair of the mercy of Allah. Seek the mercy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The mushriks in the times of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about them that they have bad thinking about Allah, which led them to great shirk. That is when Allah says, Al-Mushrikeen wal-Mushrikat, Al-Dhanneen billahi dhanna as-saw. And he said in another verse, يَظُنُّونَ بِاللَّهِ ظَنَّ الْجَاهِلِيَّةِ. Nowadays, the mushriks have this thinking about Allah, and worse. The mushriks at that time thought that Allah's mercy could not be received except through a channel, either an angel or a pious man. Nowadays, they think that Allah has left it all for the walis, and he doesn't want anyone else to turn to him anymore. He doesn't want anyone to worship him by calling him or supplicating to him. This is even worse than what the Arab pagans thought, you see. And not only that, there is a story that one sheikh said he saw it by himself and heard it near the grave. He said an old woman came saying to the engraved, "You see what Allah have done to me. I am helpless, I am sick, I have this and this and this problem. So I have no one to turn to but you." You see. Now she is complaining about Allah to this dead person who can do nothing, you know, except in her false imagination and sick imagination. But you could see how much worse it got now. And some of them, when they swear by Allah, it's very easy for them to swear by Allah and lie. And they'll swear by Allah a million times if you want. But if you tell them, swear by this person, no. He would not swear. He is fearful that if he does, something bad will happen to him. You see? So now, he is considering this person in the, not only in the position of God, but much more than God, because it was easy for him to swear by Allah, not fearing the consequences. And it was very difficult for him, impossible for him to swear by Al-Abbas, or this or that. You know. So those people nowadays, unfortunately, their shirk is both in uluhiyya, ibadah, and rububiyya. And their shirk is both in easy times and hard times. While the Arab shirk were only in uluhiyya, not in rububiyya. And the Arab shirk was in uluhiyya and only in ease times, times of ease, not times of difficulties. In times of difficulties, they would only supplicate to Allah, as Allah said in Quran about them. Ikrimah ibn Abi Jahl, the son of Abu Jahl, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam declared his blood to be unsacred because he has been showing great animosity for the Prophet ﷺ and a lot of things. So he went on a trip running away. And during the trip, the ship was about to drown. So the people told each other, the people were the mushriks. They said, "Now forget about your earthly gods. Only supplicate to Allah." So Ikrimah thought in that time, and he said, "I don't think Muhammad has asked more than that from us. So why are we running away from him?" So he said, "If Allah saves me from this, I will go and put my hand in the hand of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam." And that's what happened. Allah saved them, and he came and became a Muslim, and he became one of the biggest leaders of jihad in Islam. So this is the point. Nowadays, those people, their biggest problem is they don't know what is the meaning of worship. So they worship other than Allah and they call it other names. They say we are making tawassut. Tawassut is the same thing that the mushriks did, and that is shafa'ah. Make an intercessor between you and Allah in dua or whatever. And they say we are making tawassul. Tawassul is not this. Tawassul, the Arabic word, tawassul, is the same as tawassul, seen and saad, just like sirat and sirat. Also, wasilah and wasilah, the same meaning. Wasilah is something that makes you close to Allah, something that attaches you to Allah. What is the thing in Islam which brings you close to Allah? It is to obey Him and to obey His Messenger. That's it. That's why Abdullah ibn Abbas, when he explained al-wasilah, he said, al-wasilah al-qurba. Al-qurba. Yani something which brings you closer to Allah, some obedience. Salat is wasilah. Fasting is wasilah. And so on. Ali ibn Abi Talib radiyallahu anhu says in Nahj al-Balagha, al-wasilah an tu'mina billah wa malaikatihi wa kutubihi wa rusulihi wa al-yawm al-akhir wa tuqima as-salah, and so on. This is the wasilah. And there is no other meaning of wasilah. Some scholars said wasilah is al-mahabba. Ibtaghu ilayhi al-wasilah, meaning make your love for Allah only. This kind of love, which is worship, not the natural love. I'm not speaking about the natural love. Yani, if you love something sweet, or if you love hot, filfil, whatever you love. This is natural love. You love your son, you love your wife, you love your children. This is natural. This has nothing to do with worship and shirk, no. The love which has to do with worship is when you love something or you love someone to the degree that you treat him as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You treat him, you attribute to him something that cannot be attributed except to Allah. We have people nowadays who love humans, and when you ask them about those humans, they tell you they know all things. They know everything. They can do anything. They tell you things about them that no one deserves but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You see? So this kind of love is worship. Or if you love some person to the degree that you believe that you have to take everything he say, whatever he say is right. This is worship. This is not love. You can call it love, but this is not love. This is worship. You see, you cannot love someone to the degree that you think that whatever he says, even if he tells you khamr is halal, intoxicating drink is halal, you cannot accept that and say, I love him. This is worship. This is not love. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about Jews and Christians, اتخذوا أحبارهم ورهبانهم أربابا من دون الله. They have taken their rabbis and monks as lords besides Allah. How? Because their rabbis and monks told them about something halal, told them it is haram. And something haram, they said, no, it is halal. And they accepted that ruling of the scholar, knowing that it is different from the ruling of Allah, they accepted it. So this is worship, you see. This is worship. If you fear some person in a way that no one can be feared but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then you are worshipping him by this fear. Like fearing a person that he will cut your lifespan, he will shorten your life, or he will deprive you from entering paradise, or he will save you from hellfire by himself. Okay? No one can do this but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You see? Or he can delay or prevent your cure or something like that. Then you are worshipping that person. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, اخشوني ولا تخشوهم إن كنتم مؤمنين. So fear can be worship. Worship me, fear me, and don't fear them if you were faithful. So some fear can reach shirk, and some love can reach shirk. And some desire can reach shirk. If you desire from a person that he will take you to paradise, That's shirk, because you are deserving from him, you are desiring from him what no one can do but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So these are actions of the heart that if you do them in a way which cannot be done except for Allah, then you are worshipping that person again. Those people don't call them worship. They don't call them worship. They say, we love the wali. And if we ask them, what do you mean by love? They say, well, we mean that this wali has been given the power by Allah to do anything he wants. This is not love. How could you commit shirk and call it love? And the name doesn't change the action. If you commit shirk and call it love, that doesn't change the action. Tawassul, yani, is an excuse that those people use nowadays. And they use the incident when Umar رضي الله عنه made tawassul with Al-Abbas. Okay. Umar asked Abbas to make dua, and they made dua with him. That's okay. This is a kind of tawassul which is okay. You can come to someone who is alive, who can make dua, and ask him to make dua. That's okay. You can make tawassul by the names of Allah and his attributes. You can make tawassul by tawheed, like the prophets did. They said, Subhanaka. This is tawheed. La ilaha illa anta. This is tawheed. Inni kuntu min al-zalimin. Asking forgiveness by making tawassul by tawheed. This is the best kind of tawassul. Yunus alayhi salam did it. And Adam alayhi salam did it. Rabbana zalamna anfusana. Rabbana zalamna anfusana. So this is tawassul by tawheed. Rabbana. You see? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to use it in his dua. So these are kinds of tawassul which are okay. But to come to the dead person, first of all, he doesn't hear. And even if he was to hear, he cannot respond, definitely. So you cannot go to the dead. That's why no one came to the Prophet ﷺ after his death. Otherwise, Umar رضي الله عنه would not ask Al-Abbas. The Prophet was there. And the bodies of the prophets are as they are in the grave. They don't change. The earth will not eat up their bodies. But the Prophet ﷺ is dead. And he is like any other human. If he is dead, his actions are terminated. So he cannot hear you. He cannot respond, definitely. وَلَوْ سَمِعُوا مَا اسْتَجَابُوا لَكُمْ وَيَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ يَكْفُرُونَ بِشِرْكِكُمْ. So you might not call it shirk, but Allah is calling it shirk. You see? وَيَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ يَكْفُرُونَ بِشِرْكِكُمْ. That you are asking them and they don't hear. And if Allah would make them hear, they would not be able to respond. And on the day of judgment, they will declare that they have nothing to do with your shirk. This was shirk, you see.
Is the Prophet aware of his nation after his death?
This hadith is in Sahih al-Bukhari, where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam will be on his pool, in his hawd, and some people will come to drink from the pool. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam knows them that they are from his nation by the signs of prayer and wudu. But the angels will prevent them. And they will tell the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, they are not your nation. They are not your ashab. They have changed the religion. And you don't know what they have done after you. Or you don't know what they have changed. And this is also a reply on the grave worshippers, because the grave worshippers say that the Prophet is constantly given information about his nation every moment, every second, moment by moment. You see, the Prophet ﷺ in this hadith, that he will be told, you don't know what have they done after you, you see. So who are they? They are not the companions who were with the Prophet ﷺ. No. That's why in another narration he said, Usayhabi. It's to belittle them. Okay? And in another narration he said, Ummati, my nation. So those are people in this nation who made innovations. Or those companions who saw the Prophet ﷺ once in the Hajj time, and then they went back to their places and they turned away from Islam. Then they were fought and brought back to Islam.
The ones who Abu Bakr fought.
Now,
I think this is Imam Shawkani's view, right?
Yeah, I mean, some scholars say this is the meaning, and some scholars.
When he died,
he
saw them.
Wali and Karama.
The definition of Wali is in the Quran. ألا إن أولياء الله لا خوف عليهم ولا هم يحزنون الذين آمنوا وكانوا يتقون. The أولياء of Allah are the ones who have the right faith and the one who have taqwa, piety. Okay. So therefore, Sheikh Abdul Qadir al-Jilani was a great Salafi Hanbali scholar. They told him, they asked him, could there be a wali on other than the Aqeedah, the true Aqeedah, the Aqeedah of Imam Ahmad, for example? He said, no. No one can be a wali, and no one was and no one will be if he is not on the right Aqeedah. You see? And the Karama is a sign or something which is supernatural. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes it easy for someone to do something, you know. It's not a sign that he's a wali. Some signs happened in Afghanistan by common people when they were fighting the Russians. It was a just cause, and it was a good cause to kick those atheists out of Afghanistan, right? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to support the soldiers of Allah, he showed them some miracles, some things, you know. So this is okay. No problem. And they were not walis. They were not just, they were just common people. So a karama could happen for a wali, but not necessary. Not necessary. It's not a sign of wilaya. You see? And those actions which are called karama that the Rifa'i Sufis do, they put the sword here and take it out there and take some fire and put it in their mouth or something. Even Hindus do it. So, idol worshippers, they do it, you see. This is using the jinn, yani. This is nothing strange, yani. So, those so-called walis nowadays, unfortunately, most of them are wicked people. They are not walis, you see. And even if they are walis, they don't approve to be worshipped besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you see. No. As Allah said, الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَكَانُوا يَتَّقُونَ. If the person fits this description, he has the right aqidah, the right faith, and he is a pious man, truly, following the sunnah, then if something like this occurs to him, we know it's a karama. That's how we make the distinction. But if he is an innovator, as Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah was asked once, they said, we know some innovators who can walk on the water. Does that make them good people, walis? He said, if you see them walk on water and fly in the air, and they are innovators, don't believe that they are good people. You see, because the innovators can use the jinn, and they can fly them. They can make them walk on the water and make anything. The guideline is they have the right faith, the right aqidah, and they are pious people, not innovators, pious people. They do everything according to the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
Understanding the issue of barakah. Abu Waqid al-Laythi said, "We departed with the Prophet to Hunayn, and we had recently left Kufr. The Mushrikeen used to have a tree, which they devoted themselves to and hung their weapons upon. They used to call it Zat Wanwat. We passed by a tree and said, 'O Messenger of Allah, appoint for us a Zat Wanwat, like they have a Zat Wanwat.' The Prophet ﷺ said, 'Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. By the one in whose hand is my soul, those are the ways, the like of what you have said, is like what Bani Israel said to Musa, "Make for us a god, as they have gods." He said, "Verily, you are an ignorant people."
They did not do shirk. They asked due to their ignorance, because they were new Muslims. They just became Muslims. And they had some falsehood remaining from the shirk time. So they asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to make them a tree so that they can seek blessings from, just like they used to do in the time of Jahiliyyah. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, even though they were ignorants, he was not lenient with them. He spoke very strongly. He said, "Allahu Akbar. Innaha as-sunan. Qultum والذي نفسي بيده كما قالت بنو إسرائيل لموسى اجعل لنا إلها كما لهم آلهة." This is very strong. Even though they were going to a battle, you see, this is tawheed and shirk. We don't say, since we are going to a battle, we are in jihad, we can delay this for later. Only ignorance do this. Delay it for what? This is tawheed. This is the cause of jihad. This is the purpose of jihad. You delay the purpose and the cause for the means? No. So that's why the Prophet ﷺ did not keep quiet. He spoke very strongly. But since they did not do it, they did not insist on what they wanted, they were not called mushriks. And especially they were ignorants, you see. They were new Muslims, so they were ignorants. But they asked for something that the Prophet ﷺ explained to them. It is shirk. But the fact that they asked for it ignorantly means that it is not great shirk, you see. But tabarruk itself is to seek the blessings. And seeking the blessings is only from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah says in Quran, "Tabaraka alladhi biyadihi al-mulk." So anyone who fits this description, that he has the ownership in his hand, he is the one you can seek blessings from. And no one fits this description but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why you cannot seek blessings from anyone other than Allah. The prophets, Allah put blessings in them in their lifetime for great wisdom, so that they make some miracles and the faith of their followers become much stronger, because they are the foundation of the nation. Only the prophets, وَجَعَلَنِي مُبَارَكًا, as Isa alayhi salam said, or Yahya also, وَجَعَلَنِي مُبَارَكًا. So this is only for the prophets. No person other than the Prophet has blessings in his body. No person. No one came to Abu Bakr and sought blessings from his hair or his body or his spit or anything like that. And Abu Bakr was the best man after the Prophets. No one came to Umar. No one came to Uthman. No one came to Ali radiallahu anhu. And this shows that the blessings are only for prophets in their lifetime for a purpose, for a wisdom. Other than that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made the blessings from him alone. You see? Therefore, if you want to seek the blessings from a dead person, you are worshipping him because you are giving him the right of Allah alone. And you are worshipping him besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Some people nowadays, when they see some pious man or some great scholar or something, they might show some respect to him in a wrong way by kissing his hand or doing this or that or some. They only want to show that they love this person. You see? This is an innovation. This doesn't reach the blessing, seeking the blessing that is shirk. No. Seeking the blessing that is great shirk is like the grave worshippers do. They go and rub their hands over the building or the grave and things like that. And this is great shirk because no blesser but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophet is blessed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but no one can reach the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. No, that is uncertain. Yani after the death of the companions, that's uncertain, you see. Except someone who has inherited it in a near time, yani a time of, maybe Imam Ahmed and those people. They inherited it. They are 100% sure that these are the hair of the Prophet ﷺ. They can use it as a medicine and things like that, seek blessings from it. But now there is no way to tell. Yani, if you see in a certain museum some hair and they say the hair of the Prophet ﷺ, who knows what it is? Yani. You cannot seek blessings from it. This Alawi Malki, he has made a book. He put a picture of a slipper of the Prophet ﷺ, as he claims. He photographed it and he said, you can seek blessings from this.
If somebody has the actual hair, he can.
Yeah, but it's not possible after that time. Halas. How do you say it's the hair of the Prophet ﷺ? You cannot say.
هذا من فضل ربي ليبلوني أأشكر أم أكفر ومن شكر فإنما يشكر لنفسه ومن كفر فإن ربي غني كريم.